Lenbrook Drought Committee is hosting a second community forum. Once again, a guest speaker from the Sacramento County Water Agency will be on hand to discuss the ongoing drought and what we all should expect. Topics as before will cover all current water restrictions for this community. The state water system is stretched to the limit, so check back as the story continues. Live from Green Acres Nursery and Supply in Elk Grove, I'm Lauren, News 8, Sacramento.
Thank you, Lauren. The second town hall meeting is underway, and again, the speaker will be Dan, a water conservation coordinator and a veritable fountain of information.
Randy, I can't believe you just said that.
Nice work, Lauren. Switching you now to the Arbor Lodge in Elk Grove.
So this afternoon, very glad to have Dan Gwaltney here. It's the second time that he's speaking, and Dan is a fountain of information. It's not my, I just got that little tidbit, it wasn't my original thought. So Dan is an associate civil engineer. He's been with Sac County Water for 14 years, and he's Sacramento County Water Agency's conservation coordinator. So please welcome Dan.
Hello, thanks for having me here today. So as conservation coordinator for the Sacramento County Water Agency, it's my job to make sure we're in compliance with state and federal requirements, which in the past have generally meant that they kind of control our water rights as well as our ability to get grants funding. But now they've added to the list fines. So now the current situation, the state has kind of escalated that, so my role is even more important now to try to make sure that we maintain compliance with the state requirements. The state has come up with two emergency regulations this year. The first one was kind of minor. It just added some water use restrictions to our requirements that we make sure restaurants only serve water upon request, and that hotels and motels provide outreach to their customers encouraging them not to have their towels and stuff laundered every day. The second emergency regulation was much more impactful to our agency, and primary requirement from the state that impacts us is an overall 25% requirement that we reduce our water use, or excuse me, our water production by 25% below what we produced in 2013. And they distributed the 25% kind of unevenly based on how much water a given water agency typically uses per customer. So us being in Northern California with our bigger lots and our big lawns, we don't look too good in comparison to, say, the Bay Area or Los Angeles, where they've had a pretty stringent water use restrictions for many decades. So what that did is they allocated, or they created tiers which range between 4% and 36% for water agencies to have to reduce their water use. And so we ended up in a 32% bracket. I think most of the water agencies in our region are in the 28, 32, or 36% bracket. So we kind of got the short end of the stick on having to reduce our production by the most amount. And again, the state has as much as said that they want us to target, or they wanted to target, outdoor water use. And so that's kind of why they chose their methodology. Some of the other requirements of the latest emergency regulations is that ornamental turf in roadway medians can't be irrigated with potable water. Irrigation outside of newly constructed homes has to be either by drip or micro spray systems. You can't irrigate during or within 48 hours following a rain event, and we still have to work on defining, it's a measurable rain event. And then we have to work on how to kind of put that message out there for folks to know when we determine it to be a measurable rain event. As you can understand, it's not that easy to do given our region. And then lastly, the state included provisions to fine water agencies for not complying with these requirements. As I said in the past, they primarily held the ability to qualify for grants over our heads in terms of getting us to come into compliance with some of their requirements. But now it's gone to fines. And initially it would be like a $500 per day per violation fine. But if we don't come into compliance, it could be up to $10,000 per day of not meeting the requirements. So in order to comply with the 32% reduction, we had to implement the third stage of our water shortage contingency plan, which limits outdoor irrigation to one day per week. One of the, we made a variation on our formal stage three in that we allowed for watering trees and shrubs up to 3 days a week using drip irrigation. So stage three of our water shortage contingency plan was designed to reduce water use by between 25 and 50%. So again, going to 1 day a week was really the only way we could see getting to that level of reduction. Excuse me. Basically, in order for us to meet a 32% reduction on our production numbers, we have to reduce our water use in all of our discretionary areas, which is basically the amount of water that exceeds minimum health and safety levels of water use, which is typically between like 55 gallons per person per day and 80 gallons per person per day. Those are kind of the ranges that we looked at in terms of what the minimum requirements per person would be. But if we deduct that out from our total water production, in order to meet our 32% goal, we had to reduce our discretionary water use by between 52 and 72% in order to make that 32% overall. And to compound that further, most of our reductions will have to take place during the summer months when we typically have outdoor irrigation. So do the math, but we need a lot of reduction during this summer in order to meet the 32%, which the compliance period is from June, starting June of 15 through February of 2016. Again, we wanted to encourage everybody in the state is encouraging that people maintain their trees and shrubs. Those are the probably the most expensive plants in your landscape. Grass can be replanted, but certainly the trees, we need to invest in those and make sure that they stay alive. And again, that's why we're allowing watering 3 days a week. One thing you might see when you're out in the public is park districts. So some of the park districts are using recycled water, and they're exempt from these requirements. There are times at which you might see park districts watering with potable water during non-watering days. And what we've done is we've provided some flexibility to park districts. Basically, they've created water budgets for their parks based on a number of factors. They figure out the most efficient way to manage their facilities. And basically, they have to demonstrate that they're meeting our 32% reduction through use of their water budgets and through prioritizing areas that are more valuable from a public perspective. Say soccer fields or baseball fields might be prioritized over areas where you would have like a walking path or picnic area. So we're trying to provide flexibility for parks to use the water in the most effective way during this time. Also prohibited is using potable water for residential and fundraising car wash activities. Our focus is 100% on education. We nobody in our agency or any of the other agencies want to issue any fines. However, it's a requirement of the state that we have the mechanisms in place to be able to issue fines. We're going to the our board next week with a code revision as well as another program that will have a progressive enforcement policy. That basically, I think there are two written warnings, then you go to like a $50 fine, and then it kind of bumps up. But believe me, we don't want to issue any fines, and that's kind of a last resort for us to go down that road. Along with that code revision, we're going to be offering some more incentive programs. We're looking at having a cash for grass rebate program. Basically, you take tear out grass and you plant river friendly or drought tolerant landscaping, so there'll be a rebate for doing that. And along with that, you have to install drip irrigation and that kind of stuff to convert that landscaping. Also, we're offering a rebate for hot water recirculation systems, which basically it's plumbing that ties your faucet back to your hot water heater, and it recirculates so that when you turn on your faucet, you don't have that minute or two where you're waiting for the hot water. It's kind of there on demand. Another service that we offer is WaterWise house calls. Basically, you can go on our website and get the information for contacting WaterWise, which is our contractor. They'll come out and evaluate your house indoors and outdoors to make sure that your appliances are efficient. Your toilets aren't leaking faucets. Make sure your irrigation system is operating properly and tuned up. So they do a really good job. They provide a report, and hopefully it's helpful to our customers to have that as a resource. And our website is, and I hope, hopefully it's on at least one of the outreach materials I provided back there, but it's SCWA, Sacramento County Water Agency.net. Okay. So, anyways, as far as we're looking right now, we're actually pretty excited about our dune numbers. We actually achieved a 39.1% reduction for dune, which kind of puts us in line for hopefully being in compliance. Let's see here, what else? There's handouts back there on ways to save water indoors and outdoors. So some measures include installing a water sense labeled high efficiency toilets and closed washers, as well as shower heads, installing aerators on your faucets, fixing leaking toilets or faucets. You don't want to use your toilet as a waste paper basket. Try to run your dishwasher and your laundry washing machines when you have full loads. Don't run the water when you're hand washing dishes and when you're shaving, turn the water off when you can. Take a shower instead of baths. I don't know how many of you guys have the big jacuzzi tubs, but try to minimize that. Make that a special one night a week thing. and then try to limit your showers to 5 minutes. And outdoors, I don't have the little, can I borrow that real quick? Or that one. There's just, this is our water use restrictions.
And the website is on that particular
part. Yeah, there you go. So our water use restrictions are basically how we measure compliance. It has our watering days and times, as well as the other water use, most of the other water use restrictions I've mentioned. That's how we're measuring compliance. We're not looking at how much water any one individual house uses. So we're not looking at the meters and saying, okay, they've used they're using more water this year than they did back in 2013, which is our comparison month or year for compliance for us. What we've done is designed our water use restrictions with the intent of meeting the state's goal, and it doesn't require that we measure it on an individual basis, and so we're not trying to get down to that level. If we do see things like continuous water use over a prolonged period, we will contact people and notify them that they may have a leak and that kind of stuff. But we're not going to be knocking on the door saying, you know, you're using too much water through meter records. And one of the best, well, you guys have a professional landscaping firm that does your yard, but aerating your yard is really important. It lets the water soak in and lets it be as effective as possible. Sounds like you guys have got a really good program of you're kind of reallocating the resources of your landscapers to hand water trees and stuff like that, which is exactly what we need right now. And in your backyards, well, actually, do you guys maintain your backyards?
Yes.
Okay, well then never mind. Okay, so if you're trying to get the most water into your yard during the days and times where it is allowed, you want to use a methodology called soak and cycle. Basically, if you can run the water once in the morning and then again in the evening, that'll let the water penetrate a certain amount, and then by watering it in the evening, it kind of drives it down a little bit further. You just want to make sure that your run times don't result in runoff from your backyard areas out into the street or anything. Try to plant mulch in your planter areas, or don't plant, install mulch in your planter areas. That'll help retain the water, and leaving your lawn longer also helps minimize the need for water. And for your trees, it's typically best to deep water your trees once a week. Again, using drip systems, or one method is to, if you take a 5 gallon bucket and you drill a hole in the side near the bottom, I think it's an 1/8 inch diameter hole, fill it up with water. You can use that and it'll slowly allow the water to seep down and be most effective for your trees. And a common question is, what happens, you know, if we don't get rain this winter? And, you know, that's probably more like a $1 billion question, but you know, we're most likely, if we don't get a decent winter, we're looking at probably more stringent landscape restrictions, which for our agency, we don't have far to go. We're down to one day a week now. Also, there may be restrictions on construction and filling of swimming pools. We may have to get to the point where we limit new connections to our water system. And then in terms of construction water for the, you know, the big dirt moving projects, you know, that might be an issue. But I have a feeling those guys will probably work with the sanitation district to get recycled water for their major earth moving projects. So that's about all I have. I'd like to open it up for questions.
I don't fully understand recycled water and how. I don't understand the how the recycled water works, where it's coming from, and such. I have an idea, but maybe you can explain that a little bit further.
Sure. The recycled water comes from the Sacramento Regional Water Treatment Plant. They've got a facility that pumps water. You've probably all seen the purple pipes. Pumps water through those purple pipes to primarily institutional irrigation agencies like park districts and stuff like that. But there are commercial entities that are also on that. And so that's water that would otherwise be discharged back into our river that we're reusing, but it doesn't meet drinking water standards. There's a new project that's being built out of the treatment plant that's going to result in a lot more water, and it's going to actually be even better quality water. And so we're hoping to get the rights to purchase that water to kind of complement our existing portfolio. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, the other part of that is, I've lived here all my life, and the other part of that is if we're not putting water back into the river, the farmers down the road, or I'm thinking kind of down the road,
Well, you're right, the water that gets recycled, it isn't going into the river. And that's, I'm not a water rights expert. I know the state would like to see us recycle and reuse as much water as we can. But you're right, every ounce of water that's not put back into the system isn't available downstream. If you're able to use kind of marginal water, reuse it in your area and allow more of the snow melt from the mountains to go down to the other areas, I guess that's a net positive.
My question is on rebates. Are there any in place now, and if not, what's the time frame for possible rebates? And is there funding in place to fund them?
Yep. We currently have high-efficiency toilet and high-efficiency clothes washer rebates in place. After next week, we should have these other programs in place. I didn't mention the third program, so we have the cash for grass, the hot water recirculation system, and then the irrigation efficiency rebate, which is basically a program to rebate, say, upgrading to a smart controller for your irrigation system. Smart controller with like a rain gauge on it that it would know when it rains and shut itself off automatically. It might have moisture sensors in the soil to detect how much moisture is in the ground and adjust accordingly. So we're also going to include that in the rebate program.
What communities and cities does your organization represent besides what's right here?
We serve water to Rancho Cordova. Our service areas include Northgate, Arden Park, Sunrise, Mather, Laguna, Vineyard, Walnut Grove. And then we wholesale water to the Elk Grove Water District.
Yeah, I know that Elk Grove City is planning on building quite a few homes in the near future. How is this going to affect that directly?
Well, I guess it all depends on how dire things get, moving forward. I predict that if we're, in the middle of this winter and we're not getting any rain, I think there's going to be some pretty drastic measures talked about. And limiting development might be one of them. It's tough to make those calls of, who's the first to get limited on being able to conduct business. It's hard to say what's going to happen, but if it gets bad enough, it's going to have to be looked at, and they may have to.
But none of the calls have been made as yet.
Not to my knowledge. I know that we haven't made any calls like that.
Okay, thank you.
I was curious about the rest of the answer to Walt's question, which is, I understand if you're going to vote on the rebates next week, what's your approximate timeline for implementing them, and are they already funded?
we do have funding for those programs, assuming that they're approved. We have the sources identified, and the intent is to get them on the street as soon as possible. We're trying to, the very first program that we're trying to roll out is the Catch the Grass program, and our management is trying to get that set up to where people can apply immediately. So we would start next week after the approval, and we would start our pre-inspection and such associated with that program, here in the next couple of weeks.
You could probably hear me anyway.
No, I need it for the videotape, please.
Okay.
Thanks.
As far as the programs go, I know they tried that down at Del Webb and Manteca, and the money was in place, but there was no one in charge of the program. So as they go forward with this, has somebody been identified who will be in charge of implementing it?
Oh yeah, yeah. We this is a program. The Catch the Grass specifically is a program that is that our management is very motivated to get on the ground and be successful. I mean, not that we would ever put a program forth that didn't have staffing to implement it, but this one in particular is kind of important. We have a team of people, including many of our upper management folks that don't typically get involved, are very interested and involved.
Thank you.
Are there any additional questions for our speaker?
I just have a question about long-range meteorology.
It's not
how far in advance are you forecasts for your district?
In terms of weather forecasts, we have consultants that look at weather forecasting, but I've not seen anything anything long term that that predicts a wet or dry year. It's just hard to say. I don't think anybody knows the answer to that. There's a lot of talk about El Nino, this and that, but I think we're just going to have to wait and see what comes our way.
I've been hearing on the news a lot of agencies are running out of water. So,
do we know when Sacramento County Agency is going to be running out of water?
We don't anticipate it would be a number. It would be probably 4 or 5 years before we even have to start sweating too much.
Okay.
We have our Vineyard Surface Water Treatment Plant was a huge investment. It cost us $400 million to build that plant. And what that allows us to do is practice what they call conjunctive use. So what we do is during wet years, we'll pull water off surface water off the rivers, and then during dry years, we'll pump groundwater. And so what that does is allows our groundwater aquifers to recharge. Mm-hmm. And so regionally, we're doing fairly well. We can certainly we've got a lot of recharging to do because we before our Vineyard plant, and there was a lot of downdraw of our aquifers, but we're in pretty good shape. Our management isn't concerned with a short term, maybe a 4 or 5 year more drought, but it's longer term. And in reality, even if we have enough water, the state's going to allocate any extra water that we have to other agencies that don't have it. So I say that with one breath, but on the other hand, I can't predict exactly what the state's going to do if LA is out of water and we're, you know, we've got groundwater aquifers here.
So we're not in the, at the point where we might be talking about toilet capacity.
Yeah, there's not a need to panic yet, but we just need to do everything we can to try to save what we have.
Jim, we have a question right up here.
I was kind of curious, is there any plans in the future in development stages anyways for developing reservoirs in the low-lying areas versus up in the mountains? Because there is, when it does rain, there is a tremendous amount of runoff. And that adds to the aquifers underground if we have reservoirs.
Well, I'm sure everybody knows about the environmental requirements associated with getting a storage facility sited these days. Now, they've been talking for years about the sites reservoir, which would be up near, I think, up near Dunnigan on I-5 in that area. It would be an offline storage facility. They'd have to pump water into it. But in terms of a major storage project, I think they're going to tighten our belts so much, and then eventually they're going to have to go to the ag community and tighten their belts even more, and before they'll break down and allow us to build more storage.
Yeah, a few of us are interested in this instant hot water,
mm-hmm.
and we have discussed it.
Where do you stand on that, and when is it
going to
happen?
Well, there's the on-demand hot water heaters, which we don't have a rebate program for, but we're going to be putting out this rebate program for hot water recirculation systems. So I'm not sure which one you're referring to, but we're going to seek approval next week. I'm not sure exactly when the hot water recirculation program will actually be up and running, because our highest priority is the cash for grass program. I'd imagine that it'll probably be another month or month and a half after, you know, next week. So I would say the end of August before we might have something in place for that program.
Okay. There is a desalination plant in Southern California that I believe was just completed.
Do you happen to know if there are any plans to build any others in California?
No, I'm really not a statewide, you know, expert on that. I'm sure every agency, especially coastal agencies, are looking into that further, but I don't have any specific details on that.
I checked in the hot water recycling for my place, and as it turns out, because we have a manifold system in our house, they have to run lines directly from the hot water to each faucet. Otherwise, it just recycles through the manifold, and it was quite expensive to have it done.
I'll add that comment, because I checked also. We have a home that's built later. The situation there is all they have to do is put a recirculating pump above the hot water heater and a diverter valve at the farthest spigot away, and it takes care of it, because we're not all the homes here have that same manifold system.
Well,
that's
under house, I think. I'd imagine it's also more challenging for homes that are slab on grade as opposed to raised foundation to retrofit with additional something like that.
Okay. We don't want to leave yet, because our general manager, Tom Waltman, is here and is going to talk to you a little bit about what we're doing here, what we have done, what some of our plans are, and right here at Glenbrook. So, without any further ado, Tom.
I'm going to give you the interesting information on what we are doing here in Glenbrook right now, so that you understand what the irrigation schedule is and what we're doing especially for the trees. Right now, we're complying with Sac County Water's requirements for irrigation. We water one day a week, depending on your address number. You should be seeing you probably won't be seeing the sprinklers come on unless you're out in the middle of the night. But they're coming on three times a day during your day for 5 minutes apiece. We're trying, and I say this with a couple of caveats, we're trying very hard to ensure that we get enough or as much water as we can on the lawns without creating runoff, and that's kind of our standard, is that we want to get as much water as we can under the requirements, as much water as we can on lawns without creating the runoff, which is kind of the standard that they use for excessive water. We're trying to keep the grass alive. One day a week is tough. You see what the lawns look like. And we're getting as much water as we can on those lawns out there. For the drip systems, we're running those 3 days a week, three times. Those seem to be handling the shrubs fairly well and everything. I mean, they're going to be stressed. Everything's going to be stressed right now. But it seems to be holding up pretty well. Now for the big changes that we've kind of made. You notice the guys aren't out mowing as often. You probably don't notice them mowing much at all anymore. They've diverted manpower from mowing and blowing to edging, doing any weed eating and general cleanup, and then specifically hand watering each of the trees. They're on the same cycle that they've been on for the mowing cycles, but they're trying to get water each week on all of the major trees, and at a minimum, water on all of the trees once a week water on the major trees once a week with water on every tree in the facility every 2 weeks. Get that right. As we're looking at changing out some of the irrigation around the lodge, if we do start changing out some of our plants to go more drought tolerant, we'll look at things like the use of the netafin system, which is an underground net watering system that waters right to the root zones, rather than spraying or dripping on top and having the evaporation impact the amount of water that the plants are getting. Small upfront expense that we wouldn't normally bear, but long-term savings for the association and the amount of water we're putting out there and the amount of maintenance that goes into those watering systems, because the netafin systems they're no maintenance. You install them and they work. And I've installed these in other communities and they work very well. So we're looking at doing that kind of thing to kind of change the dynamic that we've got out here, become a little more environmentally friendly, become an example for not only this community but for others who want to come in here and look at what can be done. We want to be that example, especially to folks in the community, on how we can make changes, keep the place looking beautiful, and reduce our water use, be better stewards of the water that we do use. There should have been mulch rings installed in every one of those trees. The old trees, we have no contract to have that done yet. We have a price to have that done from Procida, but the board hasn't authorized that expense. I talked to Jeff, and he said it's about $75 a tree. That's installing the tree ring, the ring, the mulch, and the watering system.
Okay.
Right now, there's no point in installing beautiful tree rings around trees without getting water to them, because if you're not getting water out to those trees, tree ring is going to be drying up of the tree. We can't get enough water on those trees with the one day a week watering that we have to make putting mulch out there effective. You're not going to get enough water down to the root zone.
Aren't we just
What's a tree ring?
Okay, the tree ring is the cutout around the tree where you put the mulch in. Without installing a watering system to that area, without getting additional water to it, you're not doing anything other than putting a nice bunch of mulch around the base of the tree. You're not going to get enough water from the spray from the lawn to impact that tree. So if we don't install drip irrigation, some kind of additional irrigation to those tree rings, it doesn't matter if we do that or not. And we may as well not spend a lot of money to make the trees look pretty and watch them die. So that's the proposal that we got. Now it's expensive, but the option is to have pretty tree rings and dead trees. And I don't think that's a very good expense use of the money that we have here in the community.
Is it still on
the Hi, we noticed there's a home in Glenbrook that now has fir bark that once had lawn, and we're kind of concerned about the uniformity in the community. Could you address that, please?
Ms. Beth, would you like to speak to that?
Sure.
It's approved under the DRC guidelines that you can modify your lawns. There are two things at play here. Davis Sterling Act, the regulations that control how we can do things within an HOA, prohibit us from forbidding people to use low water landscape on their lawn. So we have to allow people to do that. We can control it, we can tell them how it's done, but we have to allow them to do it. In the DRC guideline revisions, that was specifically drawn out, the regulations which we use to control that were put into place, and people can now do that, and we can control it at the same time, to the extent that we can anyway. So does that answer the question? Thank you.
How much money can you save by redoing your lawn with the bark and the drip system or your sprinklers?
That's a question for Sac County. I can give you my opinion on that. My very uninformed opinion is that the amount of money that is spent on irrigating your lawn is actually very low.
Yeah.
It's not the money that most people are responding to when they change their lawn out. It's their stewardship of the environment and the water that we currently have. Because you can reduce the amount of water. The water is still very cheap.
But I asked that question a year ago when we were looking at doing the DRC guidelines. And the estimate that I got from Priscilla was that if you went to a drought-tolerant front yard over the turf, you would expect to see maybe a 30 to 35% savings in water usage. Now, like you, I looked at my water bill that came today or yesterday. The water component, by the time you knock out our senior citizen discount, for us at our house was $7. You know, it takes a lot of $7 to pay back the $10,000 to redo your front yard. So you have to do it for some other reason.
Right now, it's my understanding that we are not allowing people to do modifications that would increase the cost of maintaining a front yard. As long as the cost is the same, the association is good in that exchange. Once we start seeing more elaborate changes, that's something that will need to be addressed, because the association, I doubt we'd find very many people within the community who would be okay paying for somebody's very expensive front yard when they haven't done anything to change theirs.
The same thing that I've observed, that those sprinkler systems are going off at 6 and 8 o'clock. I hear a lot of so there's other people that have seen it. But that can become costly to, and the reason why I'm looking at it is from a standpoint that that's going to come out of our monies to replace those siphon systems, because like you say, they are expensive. And I know that there are people that are circumvented just by going and twisting.
Well, and that's, like I said, we're not going to go out and start taking people through enforcement, finding people for that. But I certainly want to have a talk with them about using those valves. And by the way, I didn't mention this earlier. The guys are going around, Proceda is going around and checking all of the systems. They're doing a full check of the community, and they're trying to do two cycles during the summer so that we get the guys out there making sure that the systems are coming on time, that they're putting on the right amount of water for that home or for the general settings, and that they're that the systems are functioning properly, they're not overspraying, they're dialed in as well as they can. So they're out trying to do their best to make sure what irrigation we do have is the most efficient.